Okay, good morning, everybody. Good to see you here. Boy, that was good and loud. You heard me that time. Wow. From winter to spring in 1 week. Isn't that amazing? It's one of the great things about the state of Georgia, middle Georgia. Beautiful, beautiful weather the last couple of days. And I'm glad that those of you in this room and our friends and brothers and sisters in the fellowship hall and our church family that's watching online, I'm glad that we're here together today. So welcome, welcome, welcome. A couple of announcements, three announcements, and then one little thing we're going to do. We're going to start first with this announcement. Immediately after the service this morning, there's a meeting in the fellowship hall related to student camp for the summer. So if you're a parent, one of our middle school, high school students who will be attending camp, Jamie needs to meet with you. It won't take long. It's mostly information giving. And so just from here, go straight to the fellowship hall when we're done. Okay, so we're going to do something. We're learning our system in here. And it's fairly amazing. We're still figuring it out. But there's some cool things we can do. And so, Russell, if you're over there in the room, we need you. I need you to do what you're going to do right now. And so something's fixing to happen on these screens, maybe. And like I said, we're learning this there. Okay, and, you know, they are looking at us from that camera right there. So whatever you're doing, stop. Now, those of you who are in the fellowship hall, I need y'all all to look to your right. Everybody in the fellowship hall, look to your right. There you go. See that camera up there? We need you to wave towards that camera because we're going to wave back at y'all, okay? So, fellowship hall, y'all look at that camera to the right. Wave toward the camera, okay? We're going to wave at you. Hey, everybody, y'all waving towards this camera up here. Hey, there you go. Very good. It's amazing how we're able to connect right here, both groups simultaneously, and that's a cool thing. So, there you go. Technology, it's a great thing. I don't understand it, but it's a great thing. So, you can swap back. I think the people in Fellowship Hall don't want to have to act like they're behaving anymore. Okay, so, a couple of other things I just feel like I need to mention. Our governor, I don't know how closely y'all follow our governor, but he extended the guidelines related to how we do church and all kind of other things for 2 more weeks till the 15th of March. And the exciting thing is it's just a 2 week extension. It was a month. He was doing a month at a time. So hopefully we're getting closer and closer. I was reading yesterday there were governors in 8 or 9 different states who were getting ready to lift a lot of the restrictions. Not all of them, but some of them. But anyway, we're trying to show obedience to Scripture, to remain under the authority of those who are in authority over us. And but I want you to understand that the second something comes out of any government office that says you can't talk about Jesus, then we may not recognize that particular order. But I don't think it's going to come to that, at least in the state of Georgia. Gail and I were in Asheville, North Carolina last weekend. Okay, I'm going to tell you, the people up there are crazy. I think part of it's called, and actually, I think sometimes we don't realize how blessed we are here. And you go to some of these metropolitan areas, and it's just amazing. So anyway, you keep up with that, and we're watching it really close, and we're getting everything right on ready. To jump out there and begin to do some things that will really be meaningful. But look, we don't have to wait for those days. You can reach out to somebody, call somebody, visit somebody, let them know, hey, we miss you. Don't call them up and say, hey, why aren't you in church? Just call them and say, we miss you. Look forward to you coming back. It's not the same without you. We're not complete without you. Your Sunday school classes and your small groups, if you're like, well, I don't know everybody that's on my Sunday school roll, call Jennifer at the office. She'll give you a copy of your roll. And you can just go right there and do that. And so the last announcement before we pray and sing has to do with next Sunday, which will be the first Sunday in March. February's over after today, I guess. Yeah. And so next Sunday, now it's going to be again, we've done this three times. Now this will be the fourth time. Now, next Sunday, the live service will be in the fellowship hall. And this room will be the overflow room. Of course, it'll be on the screen, as it always is. But we'll flip-flop over there into the fellowship hall starting next week. We've got a lot of people dealing with stuff in their lives. Our prayer list that we look at on Wednesday nights. I hope that you pay attention to that and want to pray for each other, whether it's coronavirus related, whether it's people dealing with grief. There's Martha right there, Miss Martha Stroop. It's so encouraging to see her here today. And Miss Martha, there are some women in this room who know exactly where you are. And I know that they're being faithful to pray for you. Katie, I got my grandpa birthday card. Thank you so much. Katie was sharing with me some concern that both of her grandfathers have passed away, and it made her sad. And I said, well, I will volunteer to be your new grandpa. And she gave me a birthday card. Happy birthday, Grandpa. So anyway, that's great. Thank you for that. So let's be faithful to pray for each other. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. We're gathered here in your honor. We're gathered here to bring ourselves as an offering to you. Father, way more than you desire our money or our time. Father, you so desire our heart. You just desire us to come to you with open hearts, bringing ourselves as an offering so that you can speak to us and fill us up and move in us. And Father, you do that by your Holy Spirit. And as you work in our hearts and speak to us, as you speak through your word, through music, through fellowship. So we come. And Father, we want to surrender. This is your time. And what an incredible privilege to be gathered in your name and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Chris Tomlin and Matt Redmond and Ed Cash wrote together the words of this next song. How can I keep from singing your praise? Let's stand together and join our voices in song.
our step here on this because we've got this fancy camera system. And Russell wasn't prepared for this, but we're going to see how good he is today. Ms. Barbara, would you make your way up here? Please, ma'am. This is Ms. Barbara Barnes. Come here and stand right next to me on this step. Let me ask you. There you go. Ms. Barbara has been worshiping with us. How long have you been coming here now?
About 2 years.
Our husband's been on our prayer list. I'm talking about coronavirus. He was one of the early ones around here that it really put him down. And he was in the hospital for how long?
70 days.
Yeah, 70 days. And I got to go out and spend some time with him here a little while back. And that was a lot of fun. But Ms. Barbara said that God was moving in her heart to join with the fellowship of this church, not just in attending, but to join here in service and in worship. And so she comes today. She's a believer in Jesus. She's been baptized as a believer. She likes to ride motorcycles. Yeah, so just a very interesting person. And so she comes desiring membership. And so if you rejoice in that, let it be known saying, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hey, glad to have you. I need you to just walk careful, take stay on the step, just come right here. Yeah. Frank, where are you? Frank. Hey, Frank Connor. Frank, come on up here. How you doing, brother?
Yep, you're fine.
Yeah. All right, come on, stand right there next to me. Step up one time so everybody can see how short I am. There you go. Thank you. Frank comes to us today. Frank is a member of a sister church, been baptized as a believer, knows Jesus Christ. Started worshiping with us, I don't know, 5 months ago, 5 or 6 months?
Four months.
Yeah. We were actually still in the fellowship hall with our live service, so that'll give you an idea. We swapped over here in November. God's kind of been speaking in his heart, and he feels like God's directing him to come and join the fellowship of believers here and be a part of what's going on. Frank's been tied in with Taryn Allen's Sunday school class. Taryn's back there cheering. And so he comes today. And so if you rejoice in that, let me know by saying amen.
Amen.
Amen. Welcome. So, see, here's some of that COVID stuff, okay? You know, normally we would do this at the end of service and we'd put them at the door and we could hug on them and shake their hands, and we're not supposed to do that, okay? If I catch you doing it, I'm not going to turn you in. But we're going to welcome them right here in this part of the service, and we are going to stand and give them a clap welcome to the church. Everybody stand up. Hey, glad to have y'all. Y'all can go back in your seats, and that's a great thing. And y'all can sit back down for a second because you're fixing to have to stand back up to sing, maybe. But you know, I want to tell you, God is at work. Not just, you know, we see it here. It's been so long since we've been able to come pray at the altar. I can't, you know, that's probably going to be the most exciting Sunday ever in a long time to be able to say, let's gather at the altar and pray. And you're like, when's that going to be? I don't know, but it's coming, and I'm excited about that. But we have another young man that's going to be joining our fellowship next week. He and his wife. His wife's already a member here, married couple. He's going to be coming. Feels like this is where God has led him. They're actually going to be a part of the technical team that's training back here on this. We're excited about that. And then I got to meet this week with a young lady who's never made a public profession of faith, one of our young married couples. And we talked about what that means and about what baptism's about. She's going to be coming to make her profession of faith and desiring baptism and membership, and her husband is going to be coming with her to join with the fellowship of believers here. God's at work. And sometimes we don't see it because, you know, of all that's going on, he's at work in people's lives. And we rejoice in that. So what a great thing to do right in the middle of a service. And then what a great thing to do to sing a great song right after a great thing like that. So Dwayne, please come do that right now.
Let's join our voices and our hearts together again as we sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Let's stand together as we sing.
Thank you.
Okay, so, can everybody hear? Yay. Very good. We're going to look at a passage of Scripture, 15 verses today. We're going to kind of walk through it. And in a sense, you know, I didn't do a really great job of it, but I did do a job of talking about some end time issues, some things the Bible teaches, somewhat some of the challenges of interpretation, some of the things that I feel like the Bible shares with us. But, and then, didn't Stacy do a good job last week?
Yes,
it was great. I thought, man, look how long he preached. I thought everyone would feel bad. So, he did a great job, and I wanted to come back, not to the end times issues so much. I think I shared with you 2 weeks ago. Probably I'll pick that back up, but it won't be till we're doing Wednesday night Bible study when we can really, you know, spin our wheels and some things. But I felt like it was really important for us to at least pull some of the threads of that together and tie a bow in terms of what really difference does it make to how we should be living our life today? There's so much interest in end times right now, and of course, a lot of it has to do with people wanting to know, is the coronavirus a part of the end times? And that's kind of why I jumped into that. So let me make some opening statements, and then we're going to go to 2 Corinthians. The first thing I want to say to you is this. Life, death, and eternity. Those are certainties, regardless of the tribulation or the rapture of the church or any of those things. That's a reality. Sin brought death into this world. Okay? So, really, even though we study Revelation, we study end times, we study that stuff, we need to remember that life and death and eternity are their current realities. That's not just something that's coming. I'll give you an example. Yesterday. That's recent enough, huh? Yesterday, I traveled down the road to a former church. I'd been asked to come back and lead a funeral service for a woman that I actually had recommended that the church hire, and we did. And she had been taking care of the babies in that church for over 20 years. She passed away at 91 years old. She kept babies up till she was 90. And so while we're, about the time we're ending up at a funeral service for a 91-year-old friend of mine, another funeral service was starting right here in Cochran for a young adult boy named DeAndre, who lost his life last week. You know, there's something about when somebody's 91, it doesn't really, we're like, wow, what a great life. DeAndre's life was cut way, way short. Death is reality. Doesn't have anything to do with the tribulation, doesn't have anything to do with the rapture. It's the reality of this broken world and this and what sin has done to stain creation, to stain humanity. It's a thing. And then I would say, the second thing I would say to you, and I hope you I hope you get what I'm saying here. Everything is leading to the end times. Everything. Since the Garden of Eden, when we were cast out, and angelic warriors were placed at the entrance of the garden, we have been moving towards, through the history of humanity, the end times. I don't know when they're going to start. Nobody knows. I know at the end of all time there's going to be a rapture of the body of Christ. I believe it's prior to the tribulation. Some people believe it's in the middle of the tribulation. Some people believe it's at the end of the tribulation. But I want to tell you, biblically speaking, there is a certainty that there is a rapture of the body of Christ. There is a 7-year period of horror and then the end. The heavens, the earth as we know them, they'll be burned up. The final judgment. And then we will experience basically what God was trying to create for us in the Garden of Eden. Incredible intimate fellowship with Him, with Jesus on the throne. Okay? So everything. So if somebody says to you, do you think this virus is a part of the end times? You can say, yeah. Because everything is a part, is moving us in that direction. Could this be something that hastens, because God's already got that time set, but could this be something that's a part of that process, meaning that we're getting closer? It absolutely could be. And then at the same time, and I'm not trying to be ambiguous, I'm trying to be honest in scholarship, At the same time, there could be a pastor standing in this pulpit 100 years from now saying to his people, you know, 100 years ago, there was this thing called the coronavirus, and everybody thought it was coming to an end then. And it didn't. As people have said down through the years, as they did in 1914 when the Spanish flu was wreaking havoc on our world. I want you to know also that the persecution of Christians will increase dramatically as the time draws nearer for those end time events that lead to the end of all things. It just will. Many of us here in America have never really experienced persecution for our faith. Hold on. Hold on, it's coming. If you want something interesting to read, go on the Sahoon and Google the Equality Act that our folks up in Washington are considering right now. And read about what impact it might have on me and you and the body of Christ that meets on this street corner and street corners everywhere else. The impact it could possibly have on churches who are looking to hire staff members and how they're going to have. I'm telling you, before we get to the rapture of the church, there will be just a worldwide increase in the persecution of the church. So, just know that. But I also want to remind you that this world's not our home. We're not made for this world. In Christ, we're made for a new world and a new home in eternity. We should not expect to always feel welcome here because it's not our home. Have you ever had guests come to your house that stayed just a little too long? Has anybody ever had that experience? There's a lot of guilty laughing going on. I hear that laugh up there. You know, it's not that you don't love them or don't like them. It's just like you're tired of them. And so, you know, you're like, Gail and I are going like we're going to bed, you know, so that we can shut the door, and we're like, why are they leaving? look, we are pilgrims. This is not our home. We shouldn't feel at home here. Jesus said in John 17:14, I'm just going to read it to you. You can turn there if you want to. It's not our primary scripture. But when Jesus was praying for us, this is part of his prayer in John 17. I'm just going to start at verse 14. He's talking to his Father on our behalf. He says, I have given them your word. The world hated them. I mean, he warns us up front. This world's not our home. We don't need to get too comfy cozy here, okay? The world hated them because they are not of the world, as I am not of the world. I'm not praying that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, as I am not of the world. Sanctify them, set them apart, that's what the word means, by your truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. We're here on a mission. When our mission's over, we're going home. Don't put your roots down too deep, no matter where you are. I sanctify myself for them. That's Jesus. I have set apart myself. He embraced his calling from his Father to sacrifice his life on the cross for us. I sanctify myself for them so they also may be sanctified by the truth. It's an incredible prayer. It just reminds us this is not our home. And we shouldn't be surprised when the people around us don't embrace our faith and what we stand for and what we believe. So, just having said those kind of general remarks, turn with me in your Bible. Whether you use an electronic device or whatever might be your source of scripture. We're going to be in 2 Corinthians, Paul's second letter to the church at Corinth, and we're going to be in chapter 5. And some really great stuff he says in here that by way of reminding us, okay? By way of reminding. So right here as we get ready to jump in, I want you to hear what I'm fixing to say. Okay? If you and I should not need the horror of the coming tribulation
to motivate us to share Jesus. We really should. That's kind of a negative motivation if you stop thinking about it. There's a much more beautiful, positive motivation. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1. For we know that if our earthly house, now in, right here in this verse, he's talking about not our domicile, but our body. Okay? For we know that if our earthly house, a tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands. In the context of the rest of this, he kind of goes with this whole thing. But in this very first verse, he compares and contrasts, so to speak. He talks about this body that we inhabit now is like a tent compared to what's coming. What's coming will last. It's a building. It's solid. It's for real. This tent is not. I just had my 60th birthday, so I've kind of taken a step into a whole different way of looking at life. And it looks just like it did at 59, but anyway, I was supposed to say that. But I know that I'm old enough to remember going camping, and we camped in tents back then. We didn't have motel rooms on wheels. And we would set our Sears and Roebuck tent up, and it weighed about 3,000 pounds, that tent, because it was made of canvas. And it smelled, just had a unique smell, not a bad smell, but it's like, oh, there's that camping smell. And everything was fine until it started raining. And then when it started raining, everybody rushed into the tent and brought stuff in. And then Mom and Dad started shouting a particular instruction over and over and over again. Who's ever been in there knows it. What was that? Don't touch the tent, because if you touch the tent, what was going to happen? It would start leaking where your fingerprints were, where you touched it. And all of a sudden you'd have water dripping everywhere. And so I think more children have disobeyed their parents inside a canvas tent when it was raining than at any other time in history. Tents just aren't reliable. Storms can tear them down, blow them away. There's some great videos on YouTube of people who have gone out with these new lightweight nylon tents, and they think they've got them staked down until a storm comes. And the storm just rips the whole thing out of the ground and just goes rolling. Not necessarily with anybody in it, but just, you know. And so they lose their tent. Paul's saying, look, we know that if this body that we live in right now is destroyed, we have a building. We have a new body coming. We're going to be clothed in something that is real and solid and will last. A house not made with hands. Let me explain real quick. This is a beautiful thought, beautiful imagery in the text. That phrase, not made with hands, it literally means not of this creation. In other words, one day we will inhabit a body that was not made for this creation, but was made for that eternal creation. Hebrews 9:11 kind of explains that. Now the Messiah has appeared, high priest of the good things that have come, in the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands. That is, not of this creation. Right out of Hebrews 11:9. Okay, so that's how he starts out. So I said, oh, okay, you know, what we're dealing with right now is a tent. One day, something incredible is coming. And in fact, verse 2, we groan in this one, longing to put on our house from heaven. How many of you got leaky tents? Anybody? How many are figuring out the older you get, the more that tent leaks? It does, doesn't it? Your body doesn't do at 60 like it did at 20. Has anybody else figured that out besides me? I was at, had the opportunity to lead chapel for our high school baseball team. Thank Coach Davis for that opportunity. And we were on a pretty tight schedule, so I got there fairly early. I wanted to make sure I wasn't the one holding us back. And they were still in the locker room. Nobody was out there. And I went into the batting cage, and there was a bucket of balls, and there was a bat, and there was a tee. And I thought, I hadn't hit a ball off a tee in forever. And so I started hitting balls off the tee. About 25 in, I was starting to blister up. Right? I didn't have any gloves. And I thought, great day. I woke up the next day, my rib cage was sore. From just hitting 25, 30 balls in the tent. When I was 20, that wouldn't have happened. Friday, it happened. And it's been sore longer than it used to be sore. You ever been around a really old person when they sit down? What sound do they make? That's the tent leaking. You know what I'm talking about. Same person, what sound do they make when they get up? And the sound's louder when they get up, depending on how long they've been sitting. Have you ever seen somebody get up and they get to about right here and they're like, oh my gosh. And it takes them like 5 steps to get that last part of the back up. You know, man, wait, these bodies, they limit us and they break down, and the older we get, the more we have to deal with those kind of things. We groan in this one. And because of that, and some of you young bucks in here or that are watching online or in the other room, you're kind of like, I won't be like that. I know, I said the same thing. You know, keep on. We get to where there are those days where we start actually thinking about, you know, one day it's not going to hurt anymore. One day I'm not going to have to deal with this stuff. One day my tent is not going to leak. How cool is that? We're growing in this way, longing to put on our house from heaven, that solid forever body that will be perfect and will be capable of perfect intimacy with God in heaven. Verse 3, since when we are clothed, meaning when we are clothed in our immortal bodies, we will not be found naked. Okay? I'm all about not being found naked. I don't know about you. I'm just talking about that. And this is in the sense of, if we are clothed in righteousness in eternity in this body that God has created, that means we're in relationship with Christ. We don't want to be found naked at the time of death, because then that means we're not clothed in righteousness, which means we have no relationship. We don't want to have to stand before God naked of all righteousness, do you? And if you're thinking your good works are going to be the righteousness that God's looking for, you're wrong. It is the robe of righteousness that Jesus Christ drapes on your shoulders when you stand before God the Father. Verse 4, indeed, we who are in this tent groan. I think Paul was feeling it this day. I think he must have run out of ibuprofen or Tylenol or something. Bless his heart. And you know, if you've studied enough scripture and you have, you know, Paul had some physical things that he dealt with in his life. We're not exactly sure what they are, but you know, in one place he talks about he asked God to remove this thorn in his flesh. And we don't know for sure what that thorn was, but a lot of commentators feel like it was a physical ailment of some kind of recurring thing that he constantly had to deal with, headaches, eyesight, whatever it might be. Others think it was opponents to the gospel, and either one works. Indeed, verse 4, we who are in this tent groan, burdened as we are, because we do not want to be unclothed, but clothed, so that mortality may be swallowed up by life. That's one of the most beautiful phrases in Scripture right there. Okay, I want you to listen to what Vincent said. We think we know what it means to live the good life. We have no idea. Life in its truest sense will come when we step into the presence of our Father. When our mortality, when our journey through this broken world ends, we will for the first time know the fullness of life as God meant us to know it. I just can't wait. Our mortality, our weakness, swallowed up by life. And the one who prepared us for this very thing is God, who gave us the Spirit as a down payment. Arabon is the Greek word, down payment. I mean, you know what? It's pretty clear. It's a pledge. It's a part of the purchase price, or it's property given in advance of something. It's the guarantee that this is going to happen. We have the Holy Spirit. And that reminds us, we are going to put off this tent one day, and we are going to take on this new, immortal, forever, eternal body that will allow us for the first time ever to have that face-to-face intimacy and relationship and fellowship with God in eternity. Therefore, though we are always confident and know that while we are at home in the body, we're away from the Lord. You understand that, right? That's pretty simple. Pretty simple. Okay, so all of us in here, we would be people that are in our body, our tent. And so because we're still in our tent, this old body, we are apart from the Lord in the physical sense, right? So we live by What? I heard it. Faith, yeah. We live by faith. And a lot of what Paul's talking about here, we live by faith about what's to come. And but because our hope and faith is in that, we can walk faithfully right now in these bodies while we are absent from the Lord. Verse 7, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Yet, we are confident and we're satisfied to be out of the body and at home with the Lord. Okay, I don't have to, that's a whole, there's a whole sermon that's right there in verse 8, and so I know we don't have time for it, and so that's why I'm not going to give it, but I'm going to point this out. If you are a follower of Jesus Christ, okay, or if you know someone who is a follower of Jesus Christ, when that person passes away, or when you pass away, or when you're facing death, let your faith shape how you deal with that. Makes all the difference. We're confident and satisfied. If I'm not in this body anymore, I'm home. I'm home. I've put on that building, not made for this world. This is made for the world to come, for the eternity to come. I'm home. When Nicole was when Nicole was fighting her last battle over there in Alabama, and Gail and I went over there to be there. Gail had a real close relationship with Nicole. I had made up a little sign that I took with me, and this was kind of on the heels of what I had been through. And it's something I learned. And it's true. It really is. But I made a little sign. And it just said, win-win. And I went in to Nicole's bedside in the ICU. And I had that sign. And she was a trooper. I'm talking about until the day, the minute she graduated, she was a trooper. But I just got real close to her and I said, Nicole, listen. It's win-win for you, girl. If God wants you to come home to Cochran, you'll be home in Cochran. And if God doesn't, and he wants you home in heaven, that's a win, too. It's win-win. If we understand what Paul's talking about, it's a win-win. Now, sometimes it's hard. I'm not gonna lie, it's hard to let that truth shape how we face death. Especially when it's somebody that we love, or when it's us facing that. But oh, what incredible truth that is. It's a win-win if you're a follower of Christ. Win-win. Therefore, verse 9, whether we're at home, here on earth, or away in the presence of God, we make it our aim to be pleasing to him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may be repaid for what he has done in the body, whether good or bad. Okay, there's another whole sermon there. I'm just going to say one thing. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, if you've received him as your personal Lord and Savior, you will never stand before God in judgment of your sin. Christ took that judgment for you. But you better know you're going to get to talk to God about how you lived your life. Every one of us. Those who have rejected Christ, they will be judged for their actions. And they will be forever separated from the holiness of God. For those of us who have been robed in the righteousness of Christ, we will not face that judgment because Christ took it on the cross. But you're going to have to look into the eyes of the one who died for you. And you're going to have a heart-to-heart conversation about what you did with your life. That's kind of a scary thought. At least for me. And so he says in verse 11, we're actually getting close to ending, maybe. Knowing then the fear of the Lord. And not the, I'm afraid of God, but knowing then the awesome fearsomeness of his holiness. And thus having to stand before him one day and have a conversation with him about how we live this life that His Son redeemed for us. We persuade. See, Paul's getting at what's at the heart of why he tells people about Jesus. Okay? We persuade. Patho is a Greek word that's translated persuade. It literally means to endeavor to convince. And we need to understand that when we talk about persuading people, we're not salesmen or saleswomen. We're not salespeople. I'm not trying to talk you into Jesus. What I'm doing is I'm talking to you about Jesus. And I'm talking to you about what the Bible says about Jesus. And you know who I'm letting do all the hard work? The Holy Spirit of God. It's only the Holy Spirit that can convict a sinner of their need for a Savior. You'll never persuade him. Paul understood this. He understood that the Word of God is like a two-edged sword. And man, it slices and dices. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. Convicting is the work of the Holy Spirit. All God wants us to do is to talk to people about what we have experienced of Christ and what the Bible says about Christ, and that the Holy Spirit works through that. So he says, we persuade, knowing what's coming. And this has nothing to do with the tribulation. This has nothing to do with the rapture. This is what's coming, period. Okay? Knowing what's coming, we persuade people. We persuade people. We are completely open before God. And I hope we are completely open to your consciences as well. We are not commending ourselves to you again. We're not trying to puff ourselves up, because he's accused of that. And the evidence of that is in several of his letters. But we're giving you an opportunity to be proud of us, so that you may have a reply for those who take pride in the outward appearance rather than the heart. For this is me. Verse 13, I got this verse. At least the first half of it. For if we are out of our mind. Every time I read that, I say, yep, dear Keith. God's speaking. If we're out of our mind, it's for God. Listen, walking in the steps of Jesus will seem absurd, radical, illogical to people who don't know Jesus. If we are going to live the life of Christ, you know, Paul's the one who also said, for me to live as Christ, okay? If we're going to let Christ live out his life through our hands and feet, then people are going to look at us and think, you're crazy. That's illogical. That's absurd. That doesn't make any sense. People don't do that. You don't love people that way. You don't sacrifice. You don't serve outrageously. Nobody does that anymore. Yes, they do. Followers of Christ do that. And so for those who don't understand your faith, they should look at you and think, that guy's a little loopy. That woman's not quite got it all. You know, the elevator doesn't go all the way to the top. Not because we don't make good sense, but because our love and our actions and our service and our willingness to wash the feet of the least of these baffles people. And Paul says, if we're out of our mind, it's because of God. It's because of God. He's transformed us. He's changed us. We look at life completely different. And if we have a sound mind, it's for you. So that we can share truth. So that we can teach you the ways of Christ. So that you can see what it looks like to be a follower of Christ. For Christ's love compels us. And here we go. Why in the world would we go out of our way to talk to people about Jesus? So they don't have to go through the tribulation. Nope. Sorry, you just failed that one answer quiz. Because of the love of Christ that you've experienced. The love of Christ is what compels me. That's what Paul says. And then he says, the love of Christ compels us. So it needs to compel all of us. Suneco. Suneco is the word translated compel. Some of you have a translation, probably King James or New King James, that says constrains us. Anybody here have that one? That word constrain in the translation you're looking at? It constrains us, compels us. Okay? You know, literally, you know what that word means? Suneco? Literally, it means that there's so much noise around you. Literally, Suneco is when we put our hands over our ears. Why do we do that? Why is it when Our children are preschoolers, and they're all talking to us at the same time, rapid fire, and we have no time to answer any of the questions. Why is it sometimes in the middle of that, you'll see a mama usually stand there and do this right here, or this? When we do that, what are we doing? We're shutting out all the racket. This is the idea. That's the literal interpretation of that word. The figurative is this idea of something pressing on us, of seizing us, of being so real to us that we have to do something in response to it. I'm compelled by this incredible, extravagant, outrageous, absurd, radical love that God has shown in trading his perfect son's life for the imperfect, sinless life that I have lived. That moves me. That presses in on me. It is so important. It is so vital. It is so real in my life, Paul is saying, that I am willing to put my hands over my ears and shut out anything else in order to share Jesus Christ. So great is his love. I can't speak for you, obviously. But how easily do you get distracted? How easily do things that really have no eternal importance whatsoever distract you and get you completely off track from sharing Christ? We need to learn to shuneko. When I was doing this study, I thought we need to come up with some kind of something, because that's a pretty cool word, shuneko. I like it. And we'd all be speaking Greek at the same time. Some kind of thing where we remind each other. Block it out. All the noise. Move. Live with purpose. And that is showing people the love of God in Jesus Christ. For Christ's love compels us, shuneko. Since we have reached this conclusion, if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, so that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for the one who died for them, who was raised. My friend, I want to tell you something. If you're one of those people, it's like, you know what? I'm glad I know this tribulation stuff and this rapture stuff, and I got my ticket punched. I'm good to go. And so I'm just going to kind of sit here and ride my life out. And man, I hope y'all find a ticket somewhere. I'm going to go. No, that's not what it's about. Our experience of Christ's incredible love should be all the motivation we need to share our story. Our story of meeting Christ. Our story of being transformed by Christ. See, the whole thing about salvation is it's really kind of a both-and thing. It's saved. It's Christ saves us from something, but he saves us to something more remarkable. Christ has saved us from eternal damnation. He has saved us from eternal separation from our Creator. He has saved us from an eternity that we can't, in our worst way of thinking, imagine. He has saved us by his blood, by his grace. But what he has saved us to? He has saved us to an eternity in heaven with our Creator. He has saved us to an eternity where one day we will live in this incredible city on this incredible new earth, and there will be no sun and there will be no moon. Why? Because the holiness of God will be all the light we'll need. He has saved us to a purpose in life. Before Christ, the best we can do is wander around and chase all the stuff that the world says is worth chasing. And in Christ, we find a reason for living. We find something that can compel us to sacrifice, compel us to be outrageous in our service, compel us to wash the feet of the least of these. We are saved from something, but to something incredibly beautiful, an intimacy with our Creator. Truth in the Word of God. Fellowship in the place of prayer. All, this is what we're saved to. And we're saved to a hope. A hope that this is not our home. How encouraging would it be for you if I got up here today and said, people, I want to tell you something. This is as good as it's ever going to get. That tent you're in, deal with it. It's the best you're ever going to have. Y'all be walking out of here just shout for joy, wouldn't you? No. You'd be like, oh, that. What's the big deal about that? That's right. It's that we're saved to something beautiful. Eternity with Christ. G.V. Wigram said one time, soon we shall be up there with Christ. Soon, all of us. Whether it's rapture, whether it's death, all those things are reality. But soon we'll be up there. God did not mean us to be happy without him. But God would first have us to be witnesses for him down here. To hold out as much light as we can. That's why we're here. So we're going to sing a song as we close. It's a great song. And it really kind of fits really well today. Give me Jesus. And this song will also serve as our closing prayer. And so when we're through singing, we will be dismissed. So I'm going to ask you, as our singers and instrumentalists come up, let's stand together and get ready to sing this song.
In the morning when I rise.
God bless you on your way.